doing, we're trying to control what we can, like I said, the high deductible costs, the Med Advantage plans, but you will see blips from year to year, just based upon you're going to have more retirees, and you're never really sure, like I said, how much utilization you're going to have. I'm sure you're all aware, the pharmaceutical market drives our costs for premiums, probably about 80%. 80% of what we're experiencing, what we're paying, is the usage of pharmaceutical goods. So there, you know, we are looking at some strategies. This budget cycle, is there opportunity for us to possibly go self-funded just for our prescription coverages? Is there a way for us to get some savings there? Is there a way for us to control our formularies a little bit more, being self-funded and not necessarily have to deal with the structures that, you know, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, and the HAPs are setting for us? So we are pursuing those. But overall, right now, I can tell you kind of where our numbers are at. Just know that we are still in negotiations with carriers, and then obviously we'll bring the renewals probably the first meeting in May to this body to approve. Blue Cross Blue Shield, we're looking at an overall 4.78% increase. And when I say overall, it's combining actives and retirees together. Blue Care Network, we're looking at right now a 16% increase, but we are working on adding the high cost deductible to that plan design so that it would reduce that number. And then HAP, we're looking at 1%. So, you know, we've got some work to do with the carriers yet, but that's kind of the preliminary renewal numbers that they've given us. So overall, Blue Cross Blue Shield will, combined, Blue Cross Blue Shield and Blue Care Network is 7.85%. So in theory, every suffix is going to see almost an 8% increase. So that is why, Chairman, that you will see that even though we do what we can on the savings side, we are still fighting the high cost of health insurance in the market.
Any other questions from the council?
Do the retirees have a choice whether they, which carrier they have, if they have, they get?
Through the chair, Councilman Slavin, yes, they do. It's driven by whatever their employment terms were at the time of retirement. But they do participate in an open enrollment every year, and they are able to, if they would like to see the rates, they see what the choices are, if they would like to make that move. Some of our retirees are paying a cost share at this point, some are not. But yes, they do have the opportunity to move during open enrollment if they wish.
I believe some of the contracts back in the day called for full coverage of Blue Cross in retirement.
Yeah, so that, what I believe you're referencing is the Master Medical Plan, which Blue Cross Blue Shield does not even sell anymore. So that is a product that is not even offered on the market. It's a product that we kind of put together for our retirees because we have to make equal coverage for them. But that is not a plan long-term that the city has, and most of that language was negotiated out. So it is more of the PPO plan.
It negotiated out of something that was given at the time of retirement.
So actually there's a Supreme Court, Michigan Supreme Court case on it, that you can give functional equivalent. And I think what she's saying, right, is what was specified isn't even an available product anymore. And so some unions, I think, took some folks from Macomb County, or city, whatever, to court. And that surprises you, I don't know when I saw this, but it was, you know, over the last 5, 6, 7 years, where it went all the way to the Supreme Court, the union made that argument, and the Michigan Supreme Court said that, you know, minor tweaks can be made.
Yeah, it is about equivalency.
When we switch from Blue Cross to Humana, and every time we turn around, we don't have this, we don't have that, you can't get this medication, you can't get that medication, and it's become a service.
Some of that is driven by the government too. The government decides annually every year what drugs are going to fall into what brackets. And it's nothing that's really generated by any of the carriers, providers, or even employers. It's driven by the government.
That's good.
starts on bottom of page 15 and goes all the way, it stops on bottom of page 16. So going over some high-level numbers for the fire department, the current budget is 6.3 million. The fiscal year 22 proposed budget is 6.4 million, which is about a $44,000 increase. The fiscal year 23 mayor's proposed budget is at 6.9 million, which is approximately $500,000 increase or 7%.
Looking through the, so that 500,000 increase, Chief, looks like we're looking to hire more. The wages are going up by about 600,000.
I believe there was contractual raises that were in there, and also we are hiring additional staff for this coming budget.
Can you tell me what you budgeted for? How many extra staff?
I believe
90.
Evenly spread amongst the, I guess, of those nine is the idea to make the shift at three different, three, or?
Well, we have three shifts and three stations, so each shift is, we try to keep the same amount.
Okay.
Council.
So with the nine hires, if you get them, that's why you're budgeting less for overtime?
Correct.
Through the chair, it seems like we've been getting firemen quicker than police officers.
Yeah, we got 13 in the last couple of months. I think that's
achievable.
How is the ALS doing?
I think we're trending up. We had kind of a downturn with COVID, but I think over the past couple of months, our monthly average has went up. I think it's about 154,000 a month. So I think this is a really good goal right here.
That's billed. How much is collected?
That's collections.
That's collected?
Through the chair, the ALS revenue is on page 3. Underneath charges for services, you'll see in there ALS revenue, which is budgeted for next year at 2.2 million. 2.2 million budget for next year for ALS. It's on page 3. It's included in our new charges and services revenue department.
That's 712 fire fees?
No,
right,
I'm right,
right
below
that.
Yep, right underneath it. Yep.
So, was that budgeted somewhere else back in 2017?
Or so, actually, it was terminated.
It was promptly terminated and then brought back.
Okay, so instead of me counting here, how many do we have right now?
41, that's the present. Myself and the candidate, but myself and deputy chief.
Okay, so yourself and chief and deputy and 41 on suppression?
Correct.
So that's the total amount that we have, 43 in total?
Correct.
Okay, now what's your goal? Like what do you want it to be? Like you said,
I'll rate this 9 and be 50 in suppression. Member upstairs, myself and Stan, or the deputy chief, and a clerk.
They currently already have a clerk, but it's just representing.
So
they want to put in an additional, like, fire inspector type situation.
Yeah. Okay.
So the budget shows 45 FTEs, and then say you want to go to 55. Am I reading that correctly?
Correct. Just to help you, Mr. Chairman, yes. The current staffing, the first column shows the current FTE at 45. The department requested is at 55, and then the mayor's proposed budget is at 50. That's how that translates.
And Chief, do you recall how many total firefighters we had back in 2008 when you were around?
2008?
Yeah, just off the top of your head.
I want to
budget, though.